Hi everyone, today I'm talking about sedimentology and stratigraphy, and this is the seventh lesson on this playlist so far on my channel. And today's video specifically we'll be going over bedding plane markings and structures. Specifically, we'll talk about soil marks like scour and tool marks, mud crack casts and load casts, and we'll talk about surface marks like rill and swash markings and rain, hail, and spray pits. So basically, rocks preserve in like beds or units that sometimes break apart readily and reveal markings on the surfaces, the tops of the beds, and sometimes even the soles, the undersides of the beds. And these can either be formed by current flow, deformation, or biological activity. In this video, I'm going to be focusing on those formed by currents and deformation. I will start with sole markings, or those formed on the underside, well, not formed, but preserved on the underside of bedding planes. And there are two main types of sole markings caused by currents. Those are scour marks and tool marks. We will start with scour marks. So flutes or flute casts are a type of scour mark. And these flutes are just depressions in mud caused by debris carried by a current. And these depressions become filled by overlying sand that forms flute casts. Because these fillings become preserved, the mud weathers away or breaks off the bedding plane. And what is preserved is the filling or cast. That's what a cast is, a filling. And that is why they are called sole markings. It's because they're on the bottom part of a sandy bed that overlied the mud that had the depressions in it. So when it's preserved on this underside, it looks like bumps rather than depressions because they're cast, they're filled. And flutes have bulbous noses that are pointed up current and flare and dip down current. So you can see in both these bottom pictures, the flow direction is indicated by this arrow, and it's where the noses like go down, dip downward and flare out. And flutes and their casts can range in size from 1 to 2 centimeters to over a meter in length. So it's pretty a wide range of sizes. And in terms of depositional environment, they're most common in turbidite sequences. So submarine fan type environments where turbidity currents carry sediment down into a predictable sequence of deposits. And I talk about this in the previous sedimentary structures video, as well as much more in detail in my submarine fan video, which you can check out. I will link it up here to the top right. However, the other type of current caused sole marking is tool marks. So tool marks are caused by grains rolling or bouncing along the mud surface, leaving marks behind, obviously. And the major type of tool mark we'll talk about right now is groove casts. So groove casts, also like flute casts, occur in sets, and they are preserved as sole markings on the bottom of sand beds that overlie the muddy substrate that the grains had imprinted and left these marks on. So they're similar in flute casts in those ways, but they don't have a direction. They have an azimuth, or they basically make a lineation or like a strike type direction that indicates flow direction, but not the direction. That makes no sense, Rachel. Basically, they show the flow like line, but the arrow can go in either direction. We don't know a definite direction for the line that these groove casts make, but we know that the flow was not perpendicular to it, if that makes sense. It has to be one of the other sides of the line. However, it can become more complicated because groove casts, as we can see in the bottom right picture, can form on top of one another. So again, they occur in sets, and a second set can come and overwrite a first set, but maybe not fully. So it partially erases a first set, but not fully. And then they go in all sorts of directions, and determining current flow direction from this is really just not easy because of this and because of their lack of directional indication. Groove casts are also common in turbidite sequences. That'll be a common occurrence in this video that I say that. They are actually rarely found along with flute casts. So it's interesting that they also occur in turbidite sequences, but not necessarily with flutes. Eddy motion is the type of motion that produces flutes and therefore flute casts, but it does not produce grooves. So that's kind of, I guess if there's eddy motion, you might get flutes, but you're not going to get grooves and flutes together because that's not what causes grooves. Other types of tool marks similar to groove casts include bounce, brush, and prod casts, as well well as roll marks. So here we'll go one by one. Basically, the top image here shows bounce marks or how bounce marks form. So saltating grains cause bounce marks. If you remember from the fluvial environment video, I believe that's where I talk about the transport of grains in solution and how you can have saltation versus traction and suspension and all these different types of transport. But saltation is kind of the bouncing of grains along the substrate. And when they bounce, they can form these bounce marks. The other type here is brush marks. This is the second image. Basically, these are less regular and kind of accidental impacts that leave slight mounds of material in front of or in the direction of the grain's movement or the current movement because the grain kind of brushes the ground and leaves a mound of material in front of where it brushed. The third image here shows prod marks that are typically things that like penetrate the substrate. So for example, like sticks can penetrate the muddy substrate, then be kind of rotated and freed by the current, leaving behind casts that have an abrupt downward termination. And that's what a prod mark would be. So they would have a down current termination and therefore indicate flow direction. Roll marks are the last type here. They kind of leave behind tread type marks like tires, basically because what they're doing is rolling across the substrate. Coiled shells, for example, can do this. And they just roll along like tires would and leaving behind their tread impacts like tires do. The next type of bedding plane marking is mud crack casts. Wow, we're moving through this. And mud crack casts, well, mud cracks in general, before I get to the cast part, we talked about them in the sedimentary structures video, the previous video, in this sedimentology and stratigraphy playlist. But just to generally review that again, they are basically cracks in mud. They're very self-explanatory, but they're obviously not formed by currents. They're just formed by the drying up of muddy plains. And when they are to be preserved, they can't preserve as cracks because cracks are voids. They're nothing that can't preserve in the rock record. So how do they preserve? By forming casts. So the mud itself is just there. It's cracked up. And then something like maybe a flood that abruptly overlays the muddy plain with sand, for example, can fill the cracks. And that sand can then become lithified and form these mud crack casts. And again, that would be a sole marking because it's on the bottom part, the sole of the sandstone bed that became preserved as the mud crack casts. And these mud cracks typically taper downward. So the casts will also kind of have a point at the end, but often that gets, you know, weathered away and it's kind of more of a blunt type of preservation. And sometimes it gets completely weathered away and that's why they're not super often preserved. But when they are, if you see these in this picture to the bottom right, you might think, oh, it kind of looks like bioturbation, like worm burrowing, but you can kind of tell the difference between mud crack casts and bioturbation type markings because the mud crack casts are typically more angled and polygonal than bioturbation, which is curvy and random. The next type of bedding plane marking is load casts. Load casts are sole markings as well, so they form on the bottom of overlying beds caused by deformation, not currents. So remember I said that bedding plane markings can form by currents, deformation, or biological activity. Well, this is the deformation type of bedding plane marking. And basically these are irregular bulbous features at the base of sandstone beds that overlie shale. And even though the shale or mudstone that underlied them wasn't preserved or may not be preserved, we know that it overlied shale because the way that these form has to be sand overlying shale. So basically water saturated mud, which is what eventually will form the shale, is deformed during unequal loading of sediment, in this case, sand, on top of the mud. So basically, when there's unequal loading, you're going to get depressions in some places and raised parts in some places, and this causes the deformation of that mud, especially when it's water saturated. It has to be water saturated to form this kind of bulbous type of load casting feature. And we can see a cross section of these load casts in the bottom right picture, where you can see the bulbous type of load casts here and where the mud rose between the load casts or the unequal loaded areas or depressed areas of the mud. It came up in what's called flame structures. The pointy in between load cast areas where the mud goes up is called flame structures. structures. And when those are preserved, it looks really cool in the rock record. But basically, these also are common in turbidite sequences. Once again, this is a common feature of today, except for mud cracks. Those don't form in turbidite sequences. Those are subaerially exposed muddy pans. And our next bedding plane marking also doesn't form in turbidite sequences. So don't get too bored with the turbidites. We're going to get to some here that aren't formed in those turbidite sequences. So basically, the next one here is rill and swash markings. These are surface structures rather than sole markings. So they form on the surfaces or tops of beds and preserve there rather than on the soles of beds, but sometimes can do both. Basically, rill markings are dendritic bifurcating upstream rivulets or little streams of water formed by the flow of a thin sheet of water, common in beach swash zones. Also common in swash zones are swash marks, which are just thin wavy lines that form on beaches. So you've probably seen these wavy lines on beaches, and these are swash and rill marks. The preservation of these markings is rare, but very indicative of a beach environment when you do see it preserved in the rock record. Also surface structures, but sometimes also sole markings, are rain, hail, and spray pits or impressions, which are small circular to elliptical pits formed in wet mud by obviously rain, hail, and spray. And rain pits are most commonly preserved as casts, actually, on the base of sand or siltstone beds, as shown down here to the bottom left, but can also form as surface markings that are depressions rather than casts if the bedding plane breaks apart in the most optimal way to see the surface markings. But again, most often the cast formation is preferable or more often preserved because it is in a coarser, like sandy, silty type of bed that is more easily preserved than the muddy substrate that the depressions originally formed in. And also, like mud cracks, their presence and preservation indicates a subaerially exposed environment where they had, you know, rain access and they weren't subaqueous. So that's it for this bedding plane marking video. If you want to check out my references as shown here, they're linked down in my description below. And if you want to check out any of these other videos in my Set Strat playlist, you can find any of these videos listed above the white arrows in the Set Strat playlist right now. It is out in that playlist. You can click the rectangle below to watch those. And the ones below the white arrows I haven't filmed yet, but by the time you're watching this, might be out already. So check that playlist down below. And thanks again for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye.